All right, this is John Cola with growingyourdreams.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. Today, of all places in the world, I'm here in Salt Lake City, Utah. And where I'm at, I'm actually at the Wasatch Community Garden Green Farm Project or something like that. And actually, the reason why I'm at this farm is actually this is the host location for this year's, and I think they've been doing it for like 8 years now, the Bee Fest. And it's presented by Catalyst Magazine. And the Bee Fest basically celebrates bees and pollinators. And besides just the bees that pollinate, there's many other creatures that pollinate. So basically, they're gonna kind of maybe transform this into a pollination festival. So with that, let's go ahead and head in to the Bee Fest. So once you guys walk into the Bee Fest, basically there's a little sign and there's all kinds of exhibitors. So the main things about this event is that there's all kinds of exhibitors that's gonna be educational and teach you guys about bees and pollinators. It also has like an talk area, demonstration area, where they're actually giving talks like every half hour, 45 minutes about a different topic, whether that's reducing pesticide use on herbs or about different kinds of bees and pollinators. And there's a little kids area to keep kids entertained. And there's actually adult projects too that I might be able to show you guys in a little bit. Anyways, this is the 8th annual Bee Fest. And this is really cool. They've been doing this now for 8 years. And this is put on by the Catalyst magazine right here. And if you guys live in Salt Lake City, you guys definitely got to get this magazine. Like, I just got into town last night and I was looking at the online version. They got all kinds of cool articles and all kinds of cool stuff in here. You guys got to know about this. So yeah, definitely cool. I'm glad that they're sponsoring this and getting the word out. And then it says that this year Catalyst magazine adopted the festival with the help of Slow Food Utah and made it a celebration of all pollinators. Bee Fest. This includes over 20,000 species of bees, butterflies, moths, beetles, ants, spiders, hummingbirds, birds, bats, and more. And so I want you guys to remember that, you know, we think we dominate the earth as humans. Like, we are a part of the earth, you know, as well as all the other creatures on the planet. And I want you guys to respect other creatures because, you know, as this earth is living right now, right? Nature has its own checks and balances. The US government doesn't have checks and balances, but the nature has its own checks and balances. And when one creature gets too many, there's another creature that'll eat that creature and balance things out again, as long as we don't mess up those nature's made systems. So hopefully in this episode, actually, I'm gonna show you guys more about pollinators, pollination, and how to incorporate some of nature's creatures into your garden so you guys can get a better production and also give a hand to nature and help them out. So just wanted to take a moment out of this episode today to remind you guys that we're still doing, for a limited time, the Growing Your Greens t-shirt fundraiser. So if you want to support me and my work, you could definitely buy a Growing Your Greens t-shirt that directly supports me to allow me to continue to make my educational videos. Plus, you definitely get a really cool organic cotton Growing Your Greens t-shirt. So yeah, check the link down below, compassiontees.com. Link is also at the end of this video. So when you're done watching the video, click over and support me while you still can, and also get a cool organic t-shirt at the same time. All right, so now we're gonna take you guys around the Bee Fest, and here's a little map, and it basically shows all the different areas. It's not super big, you know, and I enjoy that this actually event is free just to spread education. I also enjoy that it's actually on a farm. I mean, this farm is amazing in itself. Bye-bye. I might have to do an episode here just on its own because there are so many cool things going on this farm. They've been, James has been giving farm tours here. I think that he's a farm manager guy. And this that dude knows a lot of stuff. Definitely really cool. He's been talking about pollinators, and I got to hear him talk about compost. Definitely he's doing some good stuff there. Lots of different exhibitors here. So actually, I guess what I want to do is take you guys around to my favorite exhibitors here that actually you could learn something from, that actually I learned something from, to hopefully educate you guys about, you know, bees and also other pollinators in the garden. So the first exhibitor I want to show you guys actually at the Bee Festival is actually not having to do about bees directly at all, but is probably one of the most important exhibitors at this event. And actually this exhibitor is the SLC Green, which is the sustainability department at the city of Salt Lake City, and I think every city around the country should have a sustainability department that is concerned about sustainability and being more green. And the reason why they're at this event here is that they are promoting this, a pesticide-free yard. And if you guys were here and lived in the city, you guys could get one of these cool little signs to put up in your yard, right? And what they're promoting is this, a pesticide-free yard, you know? I mean, what I wanted to tell you guys is that by your actions that you take on a daily basis, you guys could help the environment or hurt the environment, and it is up to you. You know, if you go into a big box store, there's a lot of different man-made chemicals that are there to kill your weeds and kill your pests and all this stuff. But in my opinion, and based on research I've seen, these are very harmful to the environment. And if you read some of the labels, there's all these warning labels that it's probably harmful on some level to your health, your kids' health, your pet's health, and actually nature's health, right? The system of nature could be imbalanced by these chemicals. And so there is a better way. You guys don't need to purchase those chemicals. You know, they came out with a pesticide-free guide here to basically teach you guys what you need to do. And whether you guys live in Salt Lake City here, you guys could download this as a PDF file free on the slcgreen.com. In this guide, it's amazing. They talk about a lot of stuff like use organic lawn care and alternative pest management by using organic methods such as diatomaceous earth, neem oil, peppermint oils, homemade insecticidal soaps, you know, which are pretty not so bad. And different kinds of weed management by using just boiling water. I mean, these things are simple, but so why are you guys buying Roundup when you can just boil some water and basically burn the plants, right? Or you can put some vinegar on them and it's like putting acid on your skin. It's gonna basically kill the plants. And there's non-toxic ways. You guys just need to be educated about this. So even more and above getting bees or whatever, you guys gotta make sure you have a pesticide-free yard first. Super critical, super important. And so that's definitely where it all starts. Start with a pesticide-free yard to encourage beneficials in your area. I guess let's check out the next exhibitor. So the next exhibitor I'm at today is the Wasatch Beekeepers Association. If you guys keep bees here in Wasatch County, you guys want to definitely join them because they just basically have meetings and they talk about keeping bees and how to deal with different, you know, pest problems and beehives, and they just talk bee. Like I like to talk gardening, they talk bee. But anyways, you can see that there's like a little demonstration hive here, and you know, when people think of like pollinators, they think honeybees, you know. And hey, I love honeybees, they're great, but honeybees account for like 30% of maybe the pollination. There's more kinds of bees than just the imported European honeybees. There's like all these native bees that we'll learn about in a little bit. And I want you guys to just think about this though, is like right here, they have a little sign. It says a honeybee only makes 1/12 of a teaspoon of honey in her lifetime, right? And so when you're like squeezing on the honey to your waffles or adding honey to your coffee or your tea to drink, how many honeybees had to work to make that teaspoon or tablespoon or however much honey, quarter of a cup you're using in that recipe? It's taken so many bees a lot of time and their lives literally to make the honey so you guys could eat it, right? And I think we don't appreciate, you know, naturally made products. And it's like, and if you think about it, like, are the honeybees making the honey for us? No, the honeybees are making the honey for them so that they could survive the winter. And it is literally their food source. And if you think, what is honey? Well, honey is basically, they go around and they collect the nectar from the flower. So I want you guys to go around and collect your own flower nectar. I love to eat the flowers with the nectar in there. It's quite sweet, quite delicious, as well as the honeybees also collect the pollen. And you could get the bee pollen, which is basically literally flower and tree and shrub and plant pollen, and you guys could collect that too and kind of like eliminate the honeybees out of the situation. Anyways, honeybees are great. Oh, and I want to show you guys actually at this booth, they also have an amazing simple to make swarm trap. So let me show you guys that next. All right, so if you guys were here at the Bee Fest, you guys probably could have got one of the easiest to make, most inventive swarm traps for only $15, but you guys aren't here, so I'm gonna explain to you guys how you guys can make one. Basically, this is a swarm trap right here, and it's basically just some wood, some OSD or whatever they call it, particle board, plywood stuff, with a 2x4, and on the bottom there, it's just basically a pot. And so this is not rocket science. What they do is they got one of these fiber pots, you know, just made out of paper here, and then at the bottom of these pots, there's two holes. And one hole is open, the other hole they just fill with this, caulking stuff, or you could probably put some tape over it or something like that. And so now there's basically one entrance and one exit on this pot here. And then they basically just take some wood and they basically just secure this down with some screws into the wood to hold this into the wood, and then they put a backing on it. This backing is there just to support it, and so you could nail this into a house, into a tree, up something high, right? And so if you just put this up like this, the bees might find it. You might get lucky, you might get a swarm, right? But they got this special sauce, the bee attractant. So what they do is they take this bee attractant, it's actually called the Swarm Commander, premium swarm lure. And I don't know if there's a website on here. They should list a website. But anyways, you guys could Google that. And they basically spray this on like a piece of paper or a towel, and then they put it in a Ziploc bag, like one of the super thin, cheap Ziploc bags you get at the dollar store. You know, the bees could smell through the plastic. And then also you have to have it in there so that it doesn't the scent doesn't evaporate off. And then you just basically put that in here, put the board down, and then just attach that, and then you may collect a swarm. And once you got the swarm in here, they're gonna start building honeycomb in here, and they might live in here. But it's probably better if you just take that out then, and then put them in a traditional beehive to keep them. So yeah, an amazing swarm collector with the special attractant, so you guys could have your own honeybees that can help with certain crops. Now, the other thing I wanna say about the honeybees is that, you know, most honeybees are being used in monoculture agriculture, right? Honeybees are trucked over into California to basically pollinate all the almonds. And I think, you know, this is where nature systems are getting awry, because honeybees aren't meant to, you know, work in a field with only almond trees they're pollinating. You know, it's meant to work in a diverse farm like we are. They actually have a hive over here, and the bees are just coming around. And every time of year, there's different things in bloom. Right now I see lavender. Right now I saw, you know, different kinds of flowering herbs and cilantro and parsley here go into flower. And later in the season, there'll be different flowers. And so on a diversified farm or on your property, there's always gonna be different food for the beneficials to eat. So now I'm gonna show you guys actually the most important booth at this whole entire bee festival, right? And it looks pretty nondescript. It's a table without a tablecloth, and it's an umbrella for shade, and it has a few things on the table, just a book and a poster. But it's an amazing exhibitor, because this is actually Joseph Wilson, who's actually a professor at a local university, has been studying bees for like the last 15 years. So I mean, this dude is like a bee expert, and not just honeybees. Actually, he doesn't really know about honeybees actually, which is really cool, but he knows about the native bees that are even more important to pollination. They do probably 70% of the pollination and are even more important, and they're already in your environment. So we need to encourage these native bees. So oops. Thanks. So here's a nice poster that he made, and he took every single picture right here. And there are over 4,000 native bees in the United States. You know, and depending on where you live in the country, there may be more or less of the total 4,000. So for example, in Utah here, there's like over 1,100 different native bees. And it's totally amazing. And actually this poster is, if you love bees, and if you don't, this is an amazing poster, because these pictures are amazing. I can't give you guys any like close-ups or any details on it, but maybe I'll do a close-up shot of it. But these are all to scale times five. So basically, if the bee's big in the picture, that means reduce it times five, and that's how big it actually is. So some of these bees literally look like flies, and these bees are super important. The other thing on this chart is that you'll see that each bee is a certain kind of bee, and like some bees only like cactuses. They'll only go to cactuses, and if there's no cactuses, they're not gonna make it. So this is why planting a variety of different crops is super important, because one bee might like your borage flowers, and one bee might like your cactus flowers, one bee might like your sage flowers. So it's really important to have a variety of plants. Oh, the other thing I learned today is that if you're planting like plants, plant a lot of native plants, because a lot of native bees like the native plants. And the other thing is, when you plant the plants, plant like a big area of them, because bees will generally collect the same type of pollen. So like plant like a 3-foot area if you have the space of the same plant, and have patches of the same pollinator plant in a 3-foot area, and then just have different areas. So when they go to an area, they've got all that same kind of plant. Now the other thing you guys want to do, if you're into learning about the native bees, you want to get Joseph's book here, right? This is probably the most valuable book at this whole event here. This is actually the bees in your backyard. So I mean, everybody always says save the bees, put out water for the bees, do all these things for bees. Well, Joseph actually wrote a book with his co-author Olivia, and they have probably collectively over I think 40 years actually with the native bees. That's what they've been studying, and that's what's actually in this book. So this book will actually give you the specific things you need to do about creating and providing habitat to them, about all the different kinds of bees that live, with actually really beautiful pictures. So I mean, I would encourage every gardener to get this book to learn about your natives, because if you guys have cucumbers and you're not getting cucumbers, and you could have some soil issues, but the other thing is you're not getting pollinated. So then the thing is, do you want to do extra work, like you do the pollination with Q-tips or paintbrushes, or do you want to encourage the beneficial bees to come in your garden to do the pollination for you? And I think, it's a lot easier to maybe change some things, plant some things, so you guys could attract the pollinators to your garden if you know how. And I mean, literally, this is the Bible on how to get the native bees in your garden, which are so important. And they're also dying out, much like the honeybees, due to, habitat loss and due to chemicals and pesticides and cell phone towers and all these things that will negatively affect our other creatures here on the planet. Anyways, I learned a little bit from Joseph just talking to him, but hopefully if you click that subscribe button down below, I'll have another in-depth episode where I interview him in detail on how you guys could get more native bees, attract them to your garden so you guys could have better production and also help out the environment. So if you want to learn more about Joseph, get his cool poster. You want to check him out at beesinyourbackyard.com. So if you got here early to Bee Fest, you guys could have made your own, very own mason beehive, right? And basically they just got some bamboo, so some big pieces of bamboo that they cut in half, or you could use some bark like off a tree to basically make a shelter. And then they basically have all these different size bamboo in here, and actually some of these are like a non-bamboo. So they got these basically bamboo pieces, and so like when you guys have stakes that are like no longer good for stakes, cut them down with a little saw, and then cut them into little pieces, and then put them underneath some kind of shelter, whether that's maybe even like a plastic bottle, or in this case it's a bigger piece of bamboo, or some bark. You could put them in here and just tie them all together really tight with some string and put a hanger on it, and then hang it up, and the mason bees will come. And so you're providing bees a home. And people think, oh yeah, I gotta get a mason bee house. And yeah, you guys could buy these, you could make them with some old bamboo stakes, or in this case they're even using like this is like probably some Jerusalem artichoke stalks at the end of the season, or sunflower stalks, which are whole, so the bees may eat this out as food and or hollow it out themselves and make a little home for them. And so I think this is very beneficial. But that being said, most bees actually don't nest in these bee houses that are widely touted and widely sold, right? Most bees actually will like to live in the soil. So you want to have basically, mixtures of areas in your garden. Some of it, of course, you're going to have mulch, because that's definitely better for the soil organisms and the creatures to protect the ground. But some of the bees like to basically nest in just plain dirt. So whether you have a pile of compost or a pile of dirt or just bare dirt somewhere in your garden, right? The bees will find it, and every different bee likes a different kind of home. Some of you guys might like to live in mansions, some of you guys might like to live in a tiny house, some of you guys might like to live in apartments. And since there's so many different kinds of bees, like there's so many different kinds of people, or the native bees, they like different homes too. So I would encourage you guys to provide a lot of different habitats and areas in your garden. And I felt guilty all these years for leaving some of my soil barren and not actually mulched in my pathways, but actually I don't feel so guilty now, knowing that actually that is actually helping some of the native bee population. So what you guys probably don't understand is that when I come to one of these events to make a video like this for you guys, I walk the whole event, sometimes even twice, making sure. And actually the first time I walked by this booth, nobody was here. So I came back, I'm like, I gotta find out what they're doing at this booth, and I like to talk to people, because there's always sometimes more than what meets the eye. There might be more than what they have displayed on the table, and they might be trying to educate people about something else. So I'm glad I was able to run into them. And actually the person I was speaking to is actually watches my videos, which is kind of funny. But anyways, this is the Natural History Museum of Utah, and I'm glad they're here today, because they're talking about more than just the bees. Everybody thinks pollinators, they think bees, but there's many other creatures on the planet that do pollination. They have a little board here of different kinds of moths and butterflies, and even spiders and cockroaches, maybe not cockroaches, but beetles. And these creatures may also, maybe not directly do pollination, but indirectly by just crawling across, you know, the flowers and your plants, like the ants. You know, ants will do some level of pollination, although they could definitely be a bad thing as well. And so I want to encourage you guys to encourage beneficial insects in your garden many ways. I mean, the other thing is, like I mentioned earlier, right? You could do the hand pollination so that you have amazing flowers here that really show the reproductive organs of the flower quite well around the sides. And actually that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 males for one female, because there's the one female thing in the middle. And I like that ratio. But as I was here, there's little bees coming around and pollinating, or they're showing kids how to hand pollinate. Or you could break off a little male component and touch it to the female component to do your own pollination. But I think the insects are beneficial because they could save so much labor for us. But also, literally you are feeding them with the flowers and the pollen that they are getting and the nectar they're getting. And nature's smart, right? Nature's been set up so that, when the bees, which they really want, the nectar, to get the nectar, they actually have to go through the pollen, and a lot of bees are actually have hairs on them. So they just basically get the pollen on them inconsequentially, and then they go from flower to flower doing the pollination while they're getting their food. So, it's just really funny how nature works. And so the other thing that I learned about here, which was super valuable, and this you guys want to listen to, you want to check out this app on the iPhone store and the Android store. iNaturalist is the app, and it says learn about plants and animals in your community and even your backyard. And what this is, I get so many questions John, what's this plant? Is it edible? Is it not edible? And they send me a picture, and I didn't go to school for biology. I don't know botany. I don't know all these things. I just kind of know what I grew and what I've seen before. And so most plants I can't identify, but the iNaturalist app will identify those for you, And if it's really confident, it'll tell you exactly what it is. And if it isn't, it'll maybe give you the species or the family name, at least to set you in the right direction. And so this is one amazing app that actually I got to download and put it on my phone so I could identify. And it's not just with plants, right? It'll identify bugs. So if you got a bug, you don't know if it's a good bug or a bad bug, takes a picture of the bug, put it in the iNaturalist app, and learn about if it's a good or bad bug, so you can learn if you need to encourage it or, more importantly, discourage it in your garden. So yeah, definitely a really valuable booth, and unfortunately I think most people at this event probably just walk by. So the next exhibitor at this event, which is kind of odd for me to see, this is kind of a bee event or the bee festival, and there's a booth about spiders. But spiders, they could also be an inconsequential pollinator, but also they are a much very beneficial insect. And at the Phidibus project, I met the guy Kyle here, and actually he has a pet. I don't want to even say pet because it's really not a pet, but he basically has a jumping spider that he taught how to high five him. And it's like he took them from the wild, and then he bred them to be more gentle. And jumping spiders are not poisonous to us, but guess what? The jumping spiders, they are really voracious predators of other insects, including things like black widow spiders. So if you have the good spiders in your yard, you won't have the bad spiders. And one of his main messages today is to just, there's a lot of people that are into what's called speciesism. And you guys, John, what's speciesism? Okay, so I'll say this. You guys know what racism, right? Racism is, right? That's when you're prejudiced against something because of their color of the skin. If they're white or if they're black, if they're Chinese, you don't like them because you're racist, right? Don't be racist, that's not cool. But the other thing that's not cool is to not be a speciesist, right? It's like we're speciesists if it humans are above everything, we control everything, we could smush bugs because we rule them. Well, don't be a speciesist, right? So Kyle doesn't want you to be a speciesist against any other creature on the entire planet, right? And don't be prejudiced against them because there's certain, people that are bad, or there's certain, insects that can be bad also. And so the jumping spiders, they can hear you from across the room, right? They listen, they react to you, they can see. He takes his spiders out to look at the moon and the stars. This blew my mind, what? Spiders could look at the moon and the stars? They could hear, they could listen, and it's here's these are scientific published stuff, unexpected complexity in a spider's tiny brain, right? Who would ever thought a spider's so intelligent? And he's working with training spiders even further. I said, hey, Can you train a spider so that, you know, in the daytime he goes out into the yard and eats all the bad bugs, and then he comes back in at home, and then you could, you know, he could just lay on you? I mean, Kyle had a spider, Jennifer actually, that would stay on his laptop and just like look at him, and they'd have like a relationship together. That, you know, that's some kind of kinky stuff there. But you know, that's all right. You know, we need to have a relationship with the other creatures on the planet, not just other humans. I know a lot of you guys might have pets, dogs or cats, but hey, why not have spiders and not even call them pets, but just have a relationship with them, that they're not all bad, you know, that some of them are good, and actually they could be super cool. So if you want to learn more about Kyle and his work, which is basically strictly focused on educational work, you want to check him out at the Pidipus Project, and I'll spell that for you guys. It's Pidipus Project. He has a YouTube channel, also Facebook. Get involved there to learn more about the amazing work that he's doing. I mean, I sat and spoke with him for about like 15 minutes, and I probably barely just covered the surface, but at least I included that in this episode to let you guys know to, you know, value and appreciate other creatures on the planet besides ourselves. So I saved the best exhibitor for last, and of course, you know, for pollinators, one of the most important things you guys could do is plant the right plants to attract the pollinators and the best beneficial insects to your garden, right? In general, some of the plants that are going to do the best are herbs. So I want you guys all to have an herb garden, and not just herbs for you to eat, right? But even some of the common herbs like that we like, parsley, cilantro, some of the different like sages, even like the rosemary, some thyme. Give nature some time, and you know, these plants will attract some of the beneficial insects. And I want you guys to have a diversity. Don't just plant like only mint, but try to plant as many different herbs as you guys could have in your area. So I mean, that will benefit you and also nature, because here's the thing: every different plant will produce, you know, go to flower and all this stuff at different times of the year. And at different times of the year, there's different beneficial insects out. So you guys want to have, you know, different plants that bloom all times of the year. Like always in my garden, I know early in the season, my sage is gonna be blooming. Later in the season, I'm gonna have maybe some agastache, or what is that? Hyssop, you know, in bloom. And that's gonna definitely be really cool. But anyways, and the other thing that's really important is to plant native plants. These may not be edible for us, but they are native to some of the creatures that live around us, if you have space to dedicate and do that for them. And so as such, I found a cool, you know, seed seller here, and it's actually called Grand Prismatic Seed. And this seed company is unlike any other. I mean, I know there's a huge seed company, MVC, that I visited and have an episode on in town. But Grand Prismatic Seed Company is not just like, they just don't get seeds and package them and sell them like many other companies. They actually are growing them or wildcrafting seeds. They're selling 100% of them, right? So this is super cool. They're growing them on their farm and growing them for seeds, so you guys could get some rare, unique, and exotic varieties. And I like their name, actually, Grand Prismatic. What's a prism? Well, a prism is like one of those things when you're a kid, it shines all the lights of the rainbow and all the different colors, right? So they want to have like the full spectrum of different kinds of seeds to provide you guys, whether that's herbs, whether that's vegetables, whether that's even useful dye plants and other kind of permaculture style plants. Their goal is to have all the ones that do well in this area right here in Salt Lake City and other climates that are similar, because they grow all the plants out from seed in this climate. If it doesn't do well, they're not going to be selling the seeds to you guys, right? And so that's really cool, and I think that's the future of seed, is regionally produced seeds that are gonna really thrive and do well in your environment. And they have a whole selection, a whole catalog. You guys could check them out online. I would encourage you guys to do that, grandprismaticseed.com. And I'll just share real quick my favorite seed they have, which is actually quite rare. Let's see, I mean, they have a lot of greens, which I really like. But they have like some kind of cool Russian tomato right here. It's called Russian house tomato. And why is it called a Russian house tomato? That's because you could grow it outside in the container in the summertime and then bring it into your house during the winter time, whether you want to clip it back or whether you want to leave all the greenery on it, put it near a nice sunny window, or more importantly, get a good light on it. It'll live during the winter time inside. You're like, John, that thing's gonna sprawl all over my house, man. Tomatoes get like 10 feet tall in my garden because I'm using boogie brew and the rock dust, everything you say. Well, check it out. This is a dwarf tomato, so it's gonna stay small and compact, produce lots of little cherry tomatoes for you guys, right? And so, and yes, bees do pollinate tomatoes, but not how by you think. You know, it's not because they're collecting the pollen, it's because the bumblebees go around and buzz and vibrate. and that vibrates and shakes up the air and gets the pollen to kind of like move around on tomatoes. I mean, tomatoes are pretty much wind pollinate, but the bumblebees play an aspect to that. Anyways, what they brought here today, mostly they didn't really bring any vegetables. They brought all these beneficial pollinator crops, and people have been coming by here in droves and like picking up different ones. And as much as they have a lot of different, you know, pollinator crops, which is really cool, my particular focus is on edible pollinator crops. So I asked them which ones are edible, and actually a good percentage of these guys that they brought today are edible. Let's see here. Like, of course, the Navajo tea, you could make tea out of it. The Hopi black dye sunflower, good for dye, but you could also eat the seeds out of it. let's see, the milkweed, that's actually not good for us, but it's good for the butterflies. The safflower, of course, they make the safflower oil. You could eat the flowers on that. Let's see, of course, the marigolds, nice edible plant. This one's the one I learned about, the wild weld. So when these are young, you could eat the greens off that. Let's see here, other ones. The jewels of au pair, all right, so this is my favorite one. Like, this one will definitely feed some of the native pollinators, but also make delicious leafy greens for you guys to eat. And these ones are especially beneficial to grow in the heat. These guys like laugh at the heat in 100 degree plus in Vegas. I got all kinds of jewels of au pair to eat. And these guys kind of reseed on their own. Once you plant them once, they'll kind of come up, they'll come down, and they'll just start sprouting up in random spots. Let's see, calendula is also edible. The black cumin, the loofah, you know, makes a nice flower, but also you can eat the young baby gourds when they're young. Also, you could save them and let them get older and use them as sponges. I mean, they got a lot of cool different things. Oh, evening primrose, another one I really like to grow and include in my garden. So yeah, if you guys especially live in the area, you guys want to get these, but just because you don't live in this area doesn't mean these won't grow in like New York. Definitely during the time of year in your summer season, these will probably grow anywhere in the United States. But you know, these specifically are best for this area. And I think that's the future of seed sellers. If you want to learn more about the Grand Prismatic Seed, check them out at grandprismaticseed.com. They're two cool guys. I met them and been talking with them a bunch today. And I would definitely encourage you guys to support them and get some of their seeds. All right, so it always happens that I always stay till the very end of these events, until like literally they're shutting down, everybody's packing up and going home for the day. Luckily, I barely got all my filming done for the day to show you guys some of the most important exhibitors and things at this event. You know, I wasn't able to share with you guys some of the talks that I went to, but I tried to incorporate some of the information that I learned, you know, into this episode. There's so much to learn about the pollinators and the beneficials, and I want you guys to do your best to encourage them in your garden, whatever, on whatever level that means to you. You know, if you have extra space, make something like this. Like, John, that looks nasty. It's just a pile of wood with some wood chips and some stuff. But this provides a habitat for nature's creatures to live in. You know, spiders will like to nest inside here. They'll come out and eat your bad bugs. And we've gotten so far away from, you know, attracting and getting into having beneficial insects. You could plant plants that'll attract beneficial insects to your garden. Check the link down below to two videos I did. Actually had Rincon Vitova insectiary in Southern California, right? They will teach you guys the right plants to grow, as well as sell you the beneficial bugs to get them in your garden. And hopefully if they're happy, they'll reproduce and you'll have them year after year, so you don't have to keep buying them. But basically, we want to try to get nature systems kind of reset and rebooted how it should be, because we've gone in and done a lot of destruction. In addition, I really like the piece about those jumping spiders. You know, I want to try to get some of those jumping spiders and train them in my garden. And, you know, and they'll crawl on you, and they're just like, it was really cool. And like at one point I was sitting with Kyle, and the spider got mad and went, got like this. And then he just totally calmed down, and then it just totally relaxed a little bit because he made some kind of sudden movement, right? But those jumping spiders are not known to be biting humans. And if they do bite you, right, they could bite you and inject venom, or just bite you. And actually he said that, they bit people, but it's a conscious decision on the spider's part whether to inject venom or not. And they haven't found that they've injected venom into humans, because those spiders do not consider humans prey. Or so, like, you know, they're not gonna try to eat us or something like that. But other spiders, of course, will probably inject venom. So, you know, just because it's a spider doesn't mean you should smush it. If you see spiders in your house, hey, take a glass cup upside down with a cardboard, put it underneath there, catch it, take it outside. It's gonna do more benefits in your garden than you just smushing it and then making a spot on your wall that you gotta clean off now, right? And also, if you guys want to learn more about speciesism, I would encourage you guys to watch a movie called Earthlings. If I find a link, I'll put a link down below so you guys could watch it on YouTube to really go into like more of this speciesism that people have not really thought about, you know, in this modern day and age. Also, I want to encourage you guys to plant beneficial natives. You know, I like to plant the beneficial native edibles and also other pollinating edibles. But of course, if you have a lot of space to dedicate, you know, plant windbreaks of different kinds of natives and different kind of pollinator plants that'll be beneficial for the insects in your garden. Also provide other homes, you know, like have some of the mason bee boxes, you know, leave bare soil so some of the native bees could get in the soil and burrow and make a home. Have some areas with wood chips that are wood chip, because you know some bees will like to lay their, you know, create their young inside of wood chips. And you know, have a variety of things going in your garden. Try not to actually have it as manicured as possible. You know, I have an area in my garden just in the back that's just kind of more natural, and I kind of let it go and see what happens. And I'm providing a habitat for the beneficial creatures, and I encourage you guys to do that also. I'd also encourage you guys to check out the Catalyst magazine if you're here in Salt Lake City. Amazing magazine. I'll also put a link down below to their website online to be notified of what they're doing. Also check out Wasatch Community Gardens here in Salt Lake City, right? They got all kinds of cool educational programs and tours going on all the time. You could come here to this farm and learn about composting from the farm manager here, James. He's an amazing guy. Anyways, if you guys enjoyed this episode, I wasn't really planning on making an episode here. Hey, please be sure to give me a thumbs up. That'll ensure that in the future, I go to different events where I think, oh man, there's something that I could share with people that I think would enrich your lives. Thumbs it up, let me know. That'll encourage me to make more videos when I'm doing my random things when I travel. Also be sure to share this video with somebody else in the Salt Lake City area, somebody else that should learn about the pollinators and beneficials in their garden, because they are so important to nature's ecology that we as human beings are part of. Also be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes that are coming out every 3 to 4 days. The next episode is actually probably going to be with the native bee guy, so that's going to be a really good episode. Also be sure to check my past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1300 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel, more than any other online garden that I'm aware of. I teach you guys how to grow the healthiest food and help out the earth as much as possible. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.